Tired of missing package deliveries? I've got the perfect solution. A mailbox sensor that allows you to receive notifications directly on your phone. So stick around as I guide you through creating and setting up this fantastic mailbox sensor. Thanks to PCBWay, 3 lucky subscribers will receive mailbox sensors for free. To participate, don't forget to leave a comment and subscribe. The goal of this project was to create a compact, long-range, and energy-efficient infrared motion detector that can serve as a mailbox sensor or enhance garage security. Additionally, the sensor offers the flexibility to connect an external reed switch when the integrated one is not suitable for particular usage scenarios. In this iteration, I opted for the Atene 1616 microcontroller due to its superior energy efficiency and widespread availability in stores. And compact size was a key consideration for this version. With the aim of maximizing battery efficiency, I made a choice instead of utilizing the microcontroller's deep sleep mode during the sensor's standby phase, I opted to completely power down both the microcontroller and the radio module. This led me to devise a circuitry referred to as a power latch. To address the reed switch functionality, I implemented a single-shot trigger, utilizing a voltage supervisor. This circuitry facilitates the provision of brief power to the battery latch after the door is opened. Additionally, this approach eliminates the necessity for using pull-down resistors for reed switches, resulting in further energy conservation. I incorporated a built-in USB-C battery charger utilizing the TP4056 chip, offering the convenience of adjusting the charging current. This feature becomes imperative, especially when using the sensor with batteries of very low capacities. As you can see, the design is incredibly compact and divided into two parts. The upper section is the sensor, while the lower part is the charger. If you want, you have the option to detach the sensor from the charger. This way, the sensor becomes very small, and you can use the charger separately. So let's order the board and start the assembly. After uploading the Gerber files, which you can find on my GitHub page, most settings are automatically recognized. The only change I'll make is the color. I'm thinking of trying out red this time. As for the surface finish, I'm still contemplating. I'm quite fond of immersion gold, although it's a tad more costly. And of course, we'll need to order the SMD stencil and opt for the non-framework option. When I receive a new PCB, I feel like a child during the Christmas holidays. But being quite the lazy person, I wasn't up for manually assembling 3 boards. So without hesitation, I swiftly set up my PNP machine and began the assembly process. However, as I hadn't yet acquired all the necessary components for the machine's assembly, I had to manually install a few parts. I'm planning to upload the interactive HTML BOM file to GitHub, so you can easily carry out manual assembly of your boards. If you come across any questions, don't hesitate to ask. I'll do my best to assist you. If you're considering taking up this hobby and don't have a soldering hot plate, I recommend checking out this new option on AliExpress. It's quite affordable, priced at only $21. To power it, you'll just need a USB quick charger. Once all the SMD components are soldered in place, it's time to make a decision about the specific modification you'd like to build. This choice will depend on the battery holder you've opted for. If size isn't a crucial factor for you, you have the option to use a 14500 Li-ion battery. This means you'll need to solder AA-type battery holders. If your plan involves detaching the charger part, be careful not to cut beyond the white line. In this scenario, you'll need to solder an SMD connector for the LiPo battery. Consider using a 1C LiPo battery with built-in protection. Now comes the fun part, hand soldering, or at least it's a favorite for me. As I work on soldering, would you kindly do me a favor and give that subscribe button a little squeeze? Thanks so much. To amplify power efficiency even further, here's a neat tip. You can disable either the power LED or the PIR sensor using jumper pads. To disable them, just cut through the middle of the jumper pads. If you're considering using a reed switch, you have 2 options. You can either solder a barebone reed switch directly to the PCB, or you can opt for a kit like this one that comes with wires. The choice is yours. To program a Atene microcontroller, all you need is 3 wires. 3.3 volts, GND, and UPDI. I've found using a pogo pins clamp quite handy for this purpose, but feel free to solder wires directly if that suits you better. When it comes to programming via UPDI, you'll require a dedicated programmer. Another option is to use my open source universal UniProg programmer. It's pretty versatile. You can switch its programming mode with a simple jumper. Alternatively, you can transform your current UART programmer using the Serial2UPDI method, which you can find out more about on Google. By the way, you can discover all my pre-assembled projects on my website, link in the description below. In the Mailbox sensor sketch, there are a few settings you'll need to tweak. Firstly, there's the frequency setting, which depends on whether you're using a 433 MHz or 868 MHz LoRa module. Secondly, there are the new mail and low battery keys. It's crucial for these keys to match the ones in your gateway setup, but I'll delve into that a bit later. Now it's time to upload this sketch and dive into testing the power consumption and all the other aspects. Let the exciting testing phase begin. To assess power consumption accurately, I rely on a power profiler equipped with exceptional precision, reaching up to the level of nanoamps. This tool ensures we get the most precise measurements possible. As a default setting, the sensor transmits keys twice in a row. This approach heightens the likelihood of the receiver catching the signal. When in standby mode and employing a PIR sensor, the consumption is 12 microamps. This efficiency can offer you a couple of years of autonomy before needing a recharge. When using only a reed switch, the consumption drops significantly, reaching an impressively low 280 nanoamps. To put this in perspective, this consumption rate is even lower than the self-discharge rate of the battery itself. For the gateway hardware, my choice is the TTGO LoRa board version 2.1. While other versions are also compatible, you can find a handy table on my GitHub repository detailing all the supported versions. Just a friendly reminder, when you're uploading the firmware, make sure to specify the exact version you're using in the gateway sketch. I've written three distinct codes for the gateway, and they significantly differ from one another. Gateway underscore OLED version is tailored for offline use, meaning it doesn't rely on Wi-Fi or the internet. This version displays notifications directly on the screen. It showcases the notification count, battery status, whether it's charged or needs charging, and signal strength. Once you've retrieved a parcel from the mailbox, a simple reset action on the gateway is required. This will turn off both the screen and the LED, ensuring it's ready for the next notification. The gateway underscore WhatsApp version, specifically designed for individuals who have internet access but don't possess a smart home setup, a scenario that's quite common. The sketch includes detailed instructions on how to connect the gateway to the WhatsApp server, making it a convenient choice for many. Lastly, and a personal favorite of mine, is the MQTT version. This version seamlessly integrates with Home Assistant, enabling bidirectional communication. You can reset the status from your phone and create various automations based on the sensor status, a truly versatile choice. The only configuration you need to set up in Home Assistant is creating an MQTT sensor. I've provided a YAML example to guide you through the process. In the MQTT sketch, there are no predefined keys. It will publish whatever data it receives. Ensure that all LoRa-related settings align with those on the mailbox sensor. Additionally, remember to input your Wi-Fi and MQTT credentials. I've designed two types of support enclosure options suitable for 3D printing. The first type clips onto the battery and allows for a 45-degree swivel. It's designed for wall mounting using a screw or double-sided tape. The second type provides complete coverage for the sensor. Before delving into the range test, it's crucial to discuss a significant topic, antennas. I've conducted antenna tests using two sets. One set is optimized for 868 MHz, while the second is tuned to 903 MHz. As a result, using the second antenna on 868 MHz will yield a poor range due to unfavorable SWR. Interestingly, this very antenna showcases impressive performance at 1003 MHz. If you encounter range-related difficulties, it's worth exploring different antennas. Antennas sourced from China often evoke the feeling of taking a chance on a lottery ticket. For the range tests, I've temporarily secured the gateway onto the server cabinet. With a mailbox sensor at hand, I set off on a drive around my district. The signal consistently holds up at a range of 500 meters. Just for fun, I decided to test it inside a friend's apartment on the 8th floor. To my astonishment, the gateway managed to pick up a signal from a sensor at a distance of over 2 kilometers. Please consider subscribing for more exciting projects. Thanks for tuning in, and best of luck!